Test, test. Test, test, test. Test, test. Yeah, dude. Test, test. Test, test, test. All right, we're good. Take the music down. Good morning and happy 23rd of December. Is today the 23rd? No, 22nd of December. This is the Veterans Report with your host, Dodge Citizen. We apologize for the 30-minute delay in the start of our show today, working out some technical difficulties and just fine-tuning some of the technical aspects of our recording environment here. As the Christmas holiday approaches and New Year's approaches, of course, I'd like to send a prayer and a hope and a wish for a safe and pleasant and productive experience during these holiday weeks for our listening audience. I want to take a moment and handle some quick housekeeping notes. You can follow the Veterans Report and Dodge Citizen on my Twitter feed, which is Citizen Dodge at Twitter, or at Citizen Dodge. Citizen like the word citizen and then followed by the word Dodge with no space. Citizen Dodge at Twitter. And if you go to that Twitter feed, you will find a very substantive and daily accounting of many of the trending topics that I have highlighted or that have gleaned my attention, mostly from print media outlets like the Wall Street Journal, the Washington Post, the New York Times, the USA Today, and other digital media outlets that may have transmitted something of interest to your host relative to Veterans Affairs, as it would interact and intersect in any way in the popular culture as we know it. The music that you heard earlier in the intro is this. Turn it up a little bit. Did you turn that down?
The music?
Yes, sir. Oh, that's the call. I took it down. I did it manually, but you did as well. Yeah. That's the Call My Name beat right there. Oh, yeah. That is the unofficial theme music for the show. But it's also one of the tracks to be featured on the forthcoming Service Connected album project. If you have been following Dodge Citizen in this show, you know that I have been trumpeting the release of this album now since the inception of the show, and my hope had been that this album, the Service Connected album project, would have been released on 11 November 2016, which was Veterans Day. It looks like, much to my chagrin, you know, it will be backed up, and we are shooting for a Veterans Day, May 2017.
So you had a caller wanted to let you know you sound good, you look good, and they love the combination of the jacket, the hat, and the glasses that is working for you.
That's a joke, man.
No, that's serious. You just took the phone call.
This guy's a very humorous individual.
I'm telling you what was said, brother.
Oh, and by the way, you know what? I'm remiss anyway. That embellishment was courtesy of, just off the camera shot, the one and only Roland Grimes, media mogul, show host, entrepreneur.
Good afternoon.
He's just off the camera shot, but you can catch him live and direct Mondays
6 to 8 p.m.
And he is quite the intelligent and thoughtful purveyor of dynamic ideas and even, what do I want to say? He foments intellectual exchange and even intellectual jousting with many of his ideas. And but the bedrock of his show is from a musical posture, the funk. Am I correct, sir?
Roger that.
Okay, again, Brother Roland Grimes, 6 to 8 p.m. Monday nights. 6 to 8 p.m. Monday nights, Brother Roland Grimes. And forgot what I was talking. Okay, we're talking about the Service Connected album project. Pushed back to Memorial Day 2017. And in my military training and my home training and my business training and my training out there in these streets always educated me to not make excuses. So I'm not going to make an excuse for the album not coming out when I wanted it to, but I can give a reasonable explanation. And I will preface that explanation with, everything comes in its right and proper season in a perfect world. Everything comes in its right and proper season. And with regard to the album, since it is an artistic undertaking, and I am the person that is doing the writing and has done the writing, the music production, although I've had help with contributing producers and artisans that on the musical side. I set a time that I wanted it to be released because I've been working on this album for a while, and some of my business partners, like my music distribution partner and other people, you know, they want to push it like, hey, we want it out by this time, blah, blah, blah. And I'm with that, but there are other technical aspects with regard to the writing, the editing, the administration of publishing, the just a lot of other admin type stuff that has created some obstacles and slowed the process down. But I'm actually thankful for that, because each time I get backed up a little bit on the release date, other elements of the album or even songs have developed and been refined to be included on the album project. And and I'm thankful for that delay, because which harkens me back to my mentioning of in the proper season. So I feel like when this album comes out, the fullness and the breadth, B-R-E-A-D-T-H? Did I spell that wrong? But the fullness and the comprehensive nature of the album from the first song to the end, and the journey, by the grace of God, that the listener will go on is a more full and complete journey, and will be a more, there will be more texture, more substance in the album in its final form, because each time I've had to push the date back, by the grace of God, I've been able to perfect or even to write an entire new song or to hear something and just be able to perfect the content, for lack of a better word. So anyway, that song again, Call My Name, still working on it. The album scheduled for May 2017, Memorial Day. And that will also allow for us, because the album really should be finished. I'll be able to start sharing mixed and mastered versions of it on our website. Oh, by the way, the website for the Veterans Report is www.vetsreport.com. You're a funny guy. Listen, we're gonna go to a quick
station break. Yeah.
We're gonna take a quick station break. This guy's on Joke Time here. And we'll be back. This is your host. Oh, by the way, www.vetsreport, vetsreport.com. Check us out. We'll have a lot more information coming. My good friend, brother Milton Agers, is ripping and running today, as they say, but he may be here. We'll be back in just a little bit, sending peace and blessings out to you and yours as the Christmas and New Year's and those special family days approach. This is the Veterans Report. I'm your host, Dodge Citizen, and on my right, brother Roland Grimes. We will be back. Test, test, test. We hot. Yeah. Check me out, man. We hot. Oh, okay. Original 202 Dodge City Sun. It's the Veterans Report with your host, Dodge Citizen. My man Roland Grimes on my right, just outside of the camera shot. He hosts the Roland Grimes Show. Yes, 6 to 8, Monday nights, okay? Going to take a quick peek. I mentioned the Dodge Citizen Twitter feed. If you go to Twitter and look up at Citizen Dodge, you should see my stoic face with a microphone there. And it states, medically retired combat leader, U.S. Army officer, veterans advocate, writer, and music producer. My service-connected album project is coming soon. We currently have 935 followers, and I'm putting the word out that if you're listening to this and you know about veterans and you care about veterans and the veteran experience in the American and world culture as we know it, put the word out to follow Citizen Dodge. And you will also see vetsreport.com, which is the link to the website for this broadcast. The Veterans Report is based on, it's technically not in Washington, this show, because we actually broadcast out of a broadcast facility in Prince George's County, Maryland. But being that it's based on my experience, it is a D.C. show. And I'm in D.C. and I love Maryland and Virginia, which comprise the DMV, along with, of course, Washington. So if you go to the Veterans Report, I'm sorry, if you go to Citizen Dodge Twitter account, you will see that Veteran of the Day, U.S. Army Air Force, is Army Air Force Veteran Matthias Matt Leopold, and you can read about him. You can also read about a soldier's gift. Honors troops deployed for the holidays. You can also read that in today's paper. There was an article about the U.S. Navy doubling back, restores traditional job titles for soldiers. The Air Force chief has reported that there is a personnel shortfall in the Air Force and that it is critical. Meaning they need to get their numbers up. Might be an opportunity for certain young people that wish to be trained and get in the armed forces. A tiny sandwich shop closes to remember a beloved airman killed in Afghanistan. That's in today's Washington Post. Police have stated that 3 were arrested in a fraud scheme at Stafford Springs shop for using veterans' information. I got that. That came off of AOL.com, and I believe this happened in Denver. Veterans' duty, courage, selflessness inspire VA Secretary's holiday message. That comes from Vantage Point. And you can read that message at blogs.va.gov. Paul Weiser's veteran legacy as a World War II Navy veteran. That is also at va.gov. Ice and cold didn't stop these volunteers from honoring veterans. And I believe that's Briefs Across America and how they selflessly go out and brave the cold weather to honor and adorn veterans' tombs with wreaths to include fallen service members in the regalia and the spirit of the Christmas holidays. Veteran of the day, one day ago on VA Vantage Point, Army veteran Richard Kiern, or Kiern, I want to say if I've said his name correctly. VA reverses course and releases healthcare quality data. I guess they didn't want to release that previously, and they did. Bless Britta. Veterans Crisis Line improves service with new call center opening in Atlanta. That was one day ago. VA study finds EEG can help differentiate between PTSD and mild traumatic brain injury. That article also available on blogs.va.gov. Vet Ticks. I'll say that again. Vet Ticks. T-I-X. Like vet tickets. A Navy veteran's way of honoring those who served. Beautiful story. Replete with a beautiful image of a loving family. And that is on vetsblogs.va.gov. Army veteran Herb Weatherwax, veteran of the day 2 days ago. Nearly 100,000 vets enrolled in burn pit registry. VA Vantage Point. Actually, I'm going to open that up and bore you guys. Not bore you, but I'm going to read a little bit of that, because when I was in Iraq, many of my soldiers and persons that I was serving with were exposed to burn pits. And I'm going to read just a little bit, and I would encourage that we put the word out. And if you happen to be a veteran or a family member of a veteran, and you know they have been exposed to burn pits at any point in their service, wartime or otherwise, they need to get on this registry, because there are health complications that may be happening or may happen in the future, or just the potentiality of complications from this kind of exposure. And we're talking about upper respiratory, maybe even sleep apnea, all kinds of stuff. And I know veterans whom I served with who have since complained of complications. And it is with a heavy heart that I recall that due to the operational tempo and the necessities that were in front of us during our time in the Sunni Triangle in Iraq, oftentimes military organizations have to do what they have to do, or soldiers have to perform certain tasks. So let me just read a little bit again. Join VA's Airborne Hazards and Open Pit Registry. VA has launched the Airborne Hazards and Open Burn Pit Registry. This registry was launched in June 2014 to better understand the long-term health effects of exposure to burn pits and other airborne hazards during deployments. The number of new participants in this registry is climbing steadily and will soon reach the milestone of 100,000 participants. As of 9 December 2016, the Airborne Hazards and Open Burn Pit Registry includes 95,593 veterans and service members. An estimated 3 million veterans and service members are eligible to join the registry. The benefit of the Airborne Hazards and Open Burn Pit Registry for participants is that they can document their exposure to burn pits and other airborne hazards in an online questionnaire and print a copy of their questionnaire to discuss with their health care provider. Also, veterans can get a free medical evaluation from the VA, said Michael Montopoli, medical doctor, Masters of Public Health, and director of the post 911 era environmental health program in the VA's Office of Patient Care Services. Veterans and service members who served in the Southwest Asia Theater of Operations after August 2, 1990, or in Afghanistan, Djibouti, Africa after September 11, 2001, are eligible to participate in the registry. Participants complete a survey which asks where the veteran or service member lives, what type of work they do, and their exposures, healthcare use, and hobbies. The survey takes about 40 minutes to complete. Many veterans have reported concerns about their respiratory, cardiovascular, gastrointestinal, and dermatologic health, along with concerns about cancer. The VA would like to learn more about the experiences of those who served. The registry informs VA and DOD about the health concerns, exposures, and health outcomes of veterans and service members, said Montopoli. The registry will help provide the VA the right health care services for veterans in the future. Are you a veteran or service member who would like to join the growing number of participants in the Burn Pit Registry? If so, go to veteran.mobilehealth.va.gov/AHBurnPitRegistry. And if you didn't get all that, come to the Veterans Report or the vetsreport.com website and scroll down and you'll find this article. And again, as someone that was in Iraq and who was exposed to numerous situations, whether it was smoldering gas fires or oil fires, whether it was burning using airplane gas, you know, MoGas as they call it, jet fuel, and putting it in a pit with human feces and having to either participate in burning human feces or supervise it for hours upon hours and having to task soldiers to do the same. This is something that's very near and dear to my heart, and I've know numerous soldiers who I saw participate in these activities downrange, and who since I've watched experience the deleterious effects of that exposure. People who didn't snore, now snoring. Soldiers coughing up blood. Soldiers with unexplained upper respiratory issues and problems, coughing, choking, not breathing at night. So when I heard about this, I transmitted the information to as many of my dear friends and combat brothers and sisters in arms whom I knew had those exposures, many of whom just didn't take the time or didn't know that the government or the VA was tracking this. So again, the Burn Pit Registry. I'm sure if you just Google that, VA and Burn Pit Registry, it'll take you. But if you don't do that, go to vetsreport.com and look for it. Or rather, go to my Twitter feed, Citizen Dodge, at Citizen Dodge, and scroll down and you will see that. Okay? We'll take a little break again. I want to play a song called Faces of the Fallen. I think I played it last week. This is the, I always say that this song right here was probably the first of the songs. This song is what birthed the Service Connected album project, you know. So first song I wrote as a result of therapy for PTSD. Face of the Fallen coming at you right now. Is
See the faces of the fallen.
Okay.
Yo, it's the original 202 Dodge City Sun, straight from the heart.
We'll be back.
Yo. I see the faces of the fallen. I see them every day in my dreams when I'm walking. Always they with me. I think about the ones that fell down and couldn't stand back up. Like my man Big Pete, my man D-10, my man Boogie. From the combat objectives back on the streets again. I see the faces of the fallen and it's tearing me apart. Come on, yeah. Come on. 1, 2, how we do? I see the faces of the fallen. I read their names every day in the newspaper. So many good lives lost that we can't replace. I keep the call signs that's on the surface of my heart. Tombstones, graveyards, tough love dies hard. I see the faces of the fallen in my dreams, mommy. I feel them teardrops falling. Hear the voices steadily calling me. Distant echoes down the hallways of my heart. I see the faces of the fallen, mommy. And it's tearing me apart. I hear them calling. So many faces of the fallen. Come on. Yo, yo, I'm still here, Joe. Sometimes I wish it was with you. Every time my son smiles, I think about your kid. Yo, I remember you and everything that you did. On the battlefields, in the midst of struggle, you led from the front, never lost your humanity. Selfless service, personal courage and integrity. Without you, brother, sometimes I wonder who I'd be. Pieces of a man that trying to keep it together now. Trying to find smiles to replace the fire. Still trying to reconcile how it all went down. Each day I miss you, brother, you know I miss you right now. I dedicate this to you, I hope you hear me calling faces of the fallen. Come on, whoever figured it'd be you. Sometimes I wish it was me, so many nights I can't sleep. I'm swimming through grief, my eyes salt water, bloodshot red. Thinking about which ones died and who got there. My little homie woke up with a plate in his head. Say I can still feel the pain, but I ain't got no legs. Why they even save me, bro? Should've left me for dead. Now he's dealing with depression, the guilt of survival. Contemplated homicide, even felt suicide. He hears the voices of his homies. He hears his battle buddies calling. That's what he told me. He hears the dangling faces. Yo, he's really falling. Yo, come on. Bleeding out to a flat line, toe tag, medevac flag over the casket, dope with Delaware, I picture that. Dear Lord, I don't wanna die here. I wanna get up from this puddle of blood and help my peers. I can't feel the pain yet, don't even know I'm hurting. I'm mad at myself, cause I don't wanna be a burden. I guess it's lights out, time to go now. My combo reverie, sing a song at my night, remember me. I see the faces of the fallen and they're calling me. Come on, I'm coming home, mommy. You don't wanna see me like this. They had to keep the casket closed. mommy, no last kiss. I guess I'll see you on the other side, so keep me in your prayers. No need for despair, mommy, I know you cared. It was my time to make my egress from this life. I only wish I could have said goodbye. I never meant to make you cry, mommy. I know I lived a lonely soldier's life, a high risk, guns and warfare, bullets with no names. The politicians don't care, they play with words, they play with lies. No care for who dies, so many cruel lies. Cause cash rules everything around us. That's what my journey taught me. That's what I really care about, mommy. It's going down like that, and it just ain't fair. Among the faces of the fallen now, remember me, I say my prayers, mommy. Felt like judgment day. And when that reaper came, some had to go away. I miss my dear friends, Lord, I miss them every day. And I still hear their voices calling, calling in the wind. My homies calling, calling on me. So many memories, and they stay with me over and over, time and again. I see the faces that are falling. I see the faces that are falling, calling on me over and over.
Original 202 Dodge City Sun, and that is Faces of the Fallen, as produced and performed, written by your host, Dodge Citizen. I understand we have a caller on the line. I'm sorry, I've been remiss to tell the studio hotline is 240-455-5934. Caller, great day. Good afternoon from the Veterans Report. How are you?
I'm doing just fine. My name is Poncho Lambert. And I was really intrigued by your info on the U.S. Department of Veterans Affairs on the airborne hazards and open burn pit registry, and had some questions for you. By the way, that Faces of the Fallen is really off the hook. I'm looking forward to, you know, when I can buy that. I mean, I'd buy that for any price. That's some good stuff there.
Oh, well, first of all, thank you so much for the positive feedback, and we appreciate your listenership. And even though I always appreciate feedback about my song, and I'm heartened, and, you know, as an artist and as somebody that put it out there, you know, it always is great to hear feedback. I'm actually even more interested in your concern about that burn pit registry, because it affects so many people who, as you know, went downrange, as we call it, went to combat with the uniform on, and followed their chain of command and suffered through exposures to many things. And a lot of people just don't know about the complications from those exposures. And so this is a godsend from whatever leader. Yeah. But now, how?
Poncho.
Poncho, that was it. Mr.
Yeah,
Poncho.
Poncho Lambert.
Okay, may I call you Mr. Poncho?
Mr. Punch is fine.
Okay. My colleague over here is a very humorous individual, and we're not making fun of your name, but we have a mutual acquaintance by the name of Poncho, and he's a humorous fellow, and at first we thought that, you know, but clearly you don't sound anything like our Poncho, but we just wanted to know, we celebrate you, and we would never...
No, our Poncho can't speak English.
I don't even know anyone named
Poncho
other than me.
Yeah, but so how are you doing this morning, sir? And do you know, or this afternoon now?
Yeah, I was going to say, it's definitely after 12 o'clock.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. But yeah, thank you for your concern and your calling in to chime in about this very serious and noteworthy incidents of service members having complications from burn pit and other exposures. I was thinking during the break, actually, while the song was playing, I mentioned that burning and oil fires, but what I failed to mention is that for some units like mine, we, Poncho, when I was in the SUNY Triangle, I was part of a logistics task force that was, one of our jobs was to clear Iraqi army bases that had been abandoned. And in some of that, what we had to do, I had to dispatch work teams comprised of our soldiers that went on these bases and actually opened up warehouses and storage sites. And they had to move boxes, and some of these boxes had the Skull and Bones moniker on there for chemicals. And a lot of them, like, it, once you move one box, all of this powder and stuff started circulating around, and guys were and gals were sneezing. And, you know, a lot of times we had an interpreter with us. But in many of these instances, due to the operational tempo, we didn't have an interpreter. So my soldiers, in some cases, were going into places and coming into contact and moving stuff for disposal and whatever. And it could have been chemical weapons. It could have been anything. So when I hear about this burn pit registry, I just think it's near and dear to my heart.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
Well, my main concern here is that, you know, on the airborne hazards and open pit burn registry, there are some limitations there. And for veterans like myself who happen to be a DOD consultant now, but I was, listening to your show, and I just wanted, you know, to ask you a question about some of the limitations on there, because the, you know, registration is mainly for veterans and service members who have deployed to the Southwest Asia Theater of Operations on or after August 2nd, 1990, as well as those who have deployed to Afghanistan or Djibouti after 9/11, after September 11, 2001, and they're the ones that they're really calling for to use the registry questionnaire to, you know, report these various exposures that you've talked about on your show today, Mr. Dodge Citizen, you know, about airborne hazards such as smoke from burn pits and oil well fires and pollution, you know, during deployments, as well as other exposures and health concerns. And but it seems like they're limiting it to, you know, 1990, and for those of us that are older, that it's almost like saying on their site at the Veterans Affairs that we can't register. Now, when I was in the military, I was in Signal, and when we do exercises in Stuttgart, Germany, and up at Fort Drum, New York, like Exercise Empire Glacier, I know you've probably heard of that, where mm-hmm. we're trying to, you know, simulate Arctic environments, which means it's very, very cold.
Mm-hmm.
And when you're up there this time of year up at Fort Drum, and then you deploy to do microwave shots up into Canada and all that kind of stuff like that, and you're sleeping in a pup tent, or something without sufficient heat, and it's below 0 degrees outside.
I'm getting uncomfortable just at the description of it. Goodness gracious.
Well, yeah. I mean, literally, I couldn't, I'd wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning to go to the bathroom, and, you know, you go to pull your zipper down, and your zipper is frozen. You got to chip the ice off your zipper, you know? and that would take 5 or 10 minutes. And so you can't jump up and down in a pup tent, but, you know, you're like moving around, saying, I can't get my zipper, you know, because the ice is frozen, a half inch of ice on it and whatnot. So, but the thing about it is you just make a fire out of anything, like that diesel, you know, generator fuel and whatnot, and you're mixing it with paper or just about anything to stay warm. But I guess the point that I'm making here is that, point A is that it seems to just be catering to those veterans and excludes veterans like me that were pre-1990, even though I still look young because I use that Retin A on my skin and all that kind of stuff, you know? It seems like it excludes us. And, I just was wondering there, is that Is that how you interpret this site?
Well,
the Veterans Administration, that it excludes us old timers.
Well.
Poncho.
Yes, Mr. Punch. What I was gonna say, but and thank you so much for elaborating. It doesn't. I think the mission of this particular registry is to focus on the almost immeasurable number of soldiers that were that have come in and suffered effects from those oil fires.
Because it says, as well as other exposures and health concerns, and other exposures I got was being zapped by those microwave radio antennas, like those big dishes that you see up on the towers, and we'd have them down low, and sometimes we cook hot dogs on them, just like you cook a hot dog on a microwave oven. We put a hot dog on a stick and raise it up to the antenna while we're shooting it 40 miles into Canada, you know, so we could have something hot in our system. So, but they don't, you know, they don't seem to be catering to those of us that were exposed to that kind of, you know, radio energy and whatnot, just oil fires and whatnot. So do you think it really is expanded to include those sort of things or what? I'm still fighting with the VA to get, you know, because, you know, I literally one time got, you know, blasted by one of those microwave radio systems and had to jump off the top of the communications hut on the vehicle because it was frying my brain, just like me putting my head in a microwave oven. My wife says that's what's wrong with me now, but I don't know. You know?
Well, I think the good thing is about the VA is that separate from the registry, if you put in a claim and you let them know that this happened to me, that happened to me, and the other thing, they will still process and go about taking care of your claim in the same way. However, this particular thing about the burn pit registry is very similar to the one that they did about the Agent Orange and different just...
Like
different things where masses of people had exposures, but there was never a structured kind of response to it, you know. And,
right.
And also, I believe for scientific effects, you know, they want to have as many people participate in the registry so they can learn more about the complications, but not to focus on other people who had similar stuff. It's just, I think your stuff.
I think you're making a good point. I should probably point these things out to them when I registered today.
Oh yes, sir. Yes, sir. Indeed, and I hate to say this. But as is always the case, the squeaky, what was that old saying? The squeaky wheel gets the attention. So what I would say to you respectfully is...
Make some noise.
Yeah, continue to let the VA know about your complications and your issues. And as much documentation as possible is important. As much documentation, and I also say this, and if something happens to you or happened to you, and you're making a claim about it, and the government doesn't have your information. A lot of veterans feel like, oh, I don't have my paperwork, and I'm not going to do a claim. Well. There's actually, I spoke to a legal professional who told me that a veteran can actually force the government's hand to say, if you can't find my supporting documentation or my medical records, then it further compels the government to grant the disability that I'm asking for. I forget, there's an actual name or something, and I apologize.
Well, yeah, because that happened to me, because, you know, in my paperwork it shows where there was that, you know, where the claim was made, and then the North Capitol Street office in D.C., I don't know if they're still there, the Veterans Administration, they lost all my stuff.
Yeah,
and,
well,
you know, that was one of the things of my complaint when I left, is getting these headaches because of being, you know, I mean, you look at the back of your microwave oven, it might say 700 watts of power. And then you look at these Klystron tubes on these microwave radios, and they're pumping out 1,000 watts, you know, of directional energy right into your head and whatnot. So I'm definitely going to, to your point, make sure I point out those details.
Gosh. Oh, for certain. Yeah. And again, I can't remember which one of my, it may have been, I can't remember which one.
It's still warm, okay, with the microwave, but it would be frying your body at the same time, like being in a microwave oven, you know?
Wow. And who can say that that does not have negative and deleterious effects on the human body?
Oh, yeah.
You know? So, but wow, you make a good point. So, for veterans out here listening, the burn pit registry is there, but if you were exposed to
anything
similar, you still have a valid claim. It just doesn't fall into this registry. But your claim is there. It should be substantiated. You should definitely follow through and give them as much textured, detailed information as you can relevant to your claim, and pursue it. And do not be discouraged if you feel like, oh, I don't have any records. But the record, if you ever went to a military hospital or anywhere, the government's responsible for having those records. And I'll give you one more example. When my unit was leaving Iraq in the 04 time frame, we experienced some problems as we were doing retrograde operations out of Iraq into convoy operations. And I don't know if it was an IED or if it were what it was, but we ran into some problems where one of our 5-ton tactical vehicles that was carrying our medical records and other administrative items, paperwork and stuff like that, we saw it blow off into the desert. Lots of people's personal files and stuff.
Oh, man. Yeah. Did you get it back?
We weren't able to. We couldn't stop. It would have been, wouldn't have been tactically sound to stop a convoy. We would have been sitting ducks to be hit, small arms fire, all that whole 9 yards. And so my point is, a lot of people's stuff went up in the air, okay, and gone. A lot of our personnel files from our time. But that doesn't mean that those soldiers who were with, and I've typed more than one letter in support of soldiers' claims where I put that at the end of it, unfortunately, due to the blah, 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 many soldiers.
Right.
But the VA cannot turn around and tell a soldier, oh, well, if you don't have it, then we can't help you. Uh-uh. The soldier,
I would have thought that would have been the case.
No, they can say that, but on appeal, the soldier can say that it is the government's obligation to, by virtue of you not having it, I demand that, you know, based on the other supporting evidence from my physicians and from spouse, blah, blah, blah. So, thank you for calling, and I invite you to continue listening, to call back, and again, you're a service member, right?
So
I want to thank you for your service. We cherish you as a veteran and as a great American, and your contributions, and thank you for your very thoughtful comments about this topic. And I have a gentleman here who just walked in, caller. His name is William McCoy.
How you doing, brother?
How you doing, Mr. McCoy?
Yeah, I was listening to, I came halfway into the conversation, you know, and it is true as far as the appeal board, as basically, because you know, I'm going to appeal myself for some incidents, it is true that the appeal board, they have to prove, they have to give you the benefit of the doubt. They cannot assume, you know, they can't make their own assumption, basically. If they can't prove it, they got to give you the benefit of the doubt. So that, therefore, that you need to give them as much information that you can in your condition, you know what I'm saying? And if you can get the fellow, soldiers, you know, veterans that was with you at that time to do letters,
We did all that and submitted over a year ago since they're under the microscope to get things done, and they still haven't reacted.
Yeah, well, you
they're
know,
still it's, shucking it's, and jiving with me.
Well, I'm gonna tell you. I don't know veterans, but that's the same old song they've been singing for years. I mean, you know, and it's a song they sing to frustrate you.
We submitted 52 exhibits,
right,
including statements, and all that sort of thing as proof of people that I was in the service with, et cetera.
Let me just interject real quick something before I forget, too, and I'm going to let you go right back, gentlemen.
Okay.
Congressional inquiry and mayors or whatever political, all the way down to your... If you live in D.C., your ward, whatever ward you live in,
there you go.
Council member,
there you,
you
go.
Want them to do inquiry. Let
there
them
you
know
go.
This is such and such's office. I'm calling on behalf
good
of
point.
My constituent.
Oh.
You know, and even stuff like that helps. I'm sorry to interject.
Yeah. And he's right. You know, you got to get the you're a taxpayer and everything. You got to get your congressmen, your senators behind you. You know, and they are definitely a lot of them are adamant about the veterans. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
You got to get every piece of power you get.
I'll send them a copy of the filing.
That's all. They will hear you. They will hear you. They're not going to turn. They're going to respond. You know what I'm saying? And through that response, you know, they definitely want to send something, some type of response letter to the Veterans Administration, to whoever you're dealing with. Now, are you under an organization?
Like the Veterans of
Foreign
Like
a Veterans
War,
organization?
Yeah, service organization?
No. I hired my own attorney, and in addition to that, physicians to do their own, because you can do the expedited form instead of the VEV. And so we did it right by the book.
Okay.
We went by Code of Federal Regulations, at Chapter 38 for
right.
Veterans Affairs. We did everything by the book,
right.
And it's still been years now, you know.
Yeah, well,
and,
you know,
52 exhibits later, et cetera. Yeah.
Yeah, well,
I have one of my good friends, you know, former friend. He's a good associate now, but you know, he was not too far from me in D.C. and you know, he's tried to help, but you know.
Yeah, but you know, the best thing about that, all your effort, you know, is that no matter how long it takes them, they have to look back at, you know, once it's resolved, they're gonna have to pay you for it, all that back time. That's why you should never give up, and you should never let your claim lapse. You have to keep responding to it. You know,
right.
And like I said, you know, get those individuals and like I said, a veterans organization are very supportive, you know, because they have all the legal background, support, you know, and plus they are, you know, at every congressional hearing that deals with veterans, you have those organizations' representatives up in there. So they are well aware as far as the Veterans Administration and as far as the circuit of Congress and whatnot. So, you know, those individuals, it's good to be in one of those organizations. I mean, I'm going to tell you, you know, they have to do things in somewhat of commission, like almost like a commission. Like they, you know, they had to go through veterans and they have to show that they have, support veterans in some manner or another, and so they can be recorded as putting that effort in, you know what I'm saying? But you know, that's where you pretty much rounded on, you know, what you need and where you at and whatnot. So that's where you, in dealing with when those veteran organizations like DAV, VFW or American Legions, you have to be able to stand on your square and put your foot on, like the brothers say, you know, people say, put your foot on their neck.
Yeah.
Make sure they don't falter. You know, make sure they do everything they're supposed to do. You
mm-hmm.
know what I'm saying? Because they will brush you to the side. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Because, like, all they want to do is record that they have helped you and they want to close your case as soon as possible. Some of them do. Now, I'm not going to say all the representatives of the organization do.
Yeah, because they've just been stagnant. They've just been totally stagnant, even after hiring attorneys and hiring physicians and corroborating the things that were in the claim.
Yeah, see, that's what I'm saying. That's where you have to put your foot on their neck. You got to put the pressure on them, mm-hmm. you know, and not let them veer you to where they want you to go, because basically the bottom line, they're trying to just get some level of recognition that they did support you in to some level of your whole endeavor.
Mm-hmm.
But however, it's just the whole point that, you know, you are controlling your destiny.
And
remember this with the thing with these a congressional inquiry, and even if I don't know, let's say Mary Che in D.C. I don't know if she's, you know, she's an example of a Ward 3 or but when they send a letter, especially from Congress,
yep,
that letter has to be responded to.
That's right.
So the VA now has to respond, almost like you have to respond to a lawsuit. They got to respond. They say, in the matter of veteran so-and-so who you have stated in your constituent, as your constituent, we have, this is what's going on with the case, you know, and that is a good thing. And then you have I would do it on all three. And then DC, the veteran, the mayor actually has a veterans advisory something. I'd also call them. And the bottom line is, I hate to say it, but the more things that these people have to respond to, you know,
well, the brother said, you know, the bottom line, you know, they have to respond, right? And you expose them more and more, especially in their, you know, their fallacies. You know what I'm saying? Their persistence in trying to discredit you as a veteran. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. At the time you put your hand and swore to give your life for your country. We the number one veterans. I mean, we the number one citizens of this country. You know that, right?
Oh yeah.
Yeah. And so at that time, man. Even though it's a blessing that you did not give your life, I didn't give my life, but I was prepared to, and I did an oath to, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, you know, they are obligated to support me in every issue that I have due to my participation as number one citizen of this country, right?
Mm.
You know, and so therefore, you got to look at it like that, man. And that host that motivates you
mm-hmm.
to stand fast and to continually push mm-hmm. your efforts mm-hmm. and give it your best. And it's in God's hands.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't know what your religion belief is, but it's in God's hands. Mm. But like I said, do not give up. You know, do not give up, because that's what they want you to do, and that's what they always do. Mm-hmm. That's part of their protocol.
Mm-hmm.
The frustration to make you take you through the, you know, through the fine tooth comb of interrogation, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And to, you know, to kind of, you know, and like I said, the whole mission is to frustrate you to the point where you say, I'm not going to do it. And that's why a lot of brothers out there, you know, brothers and sisters, you know, veteran brothers and sisters out there are experiencing situation where they are taking their lives and, you know, because of the frustration. And I wish they would have, you know, came on the station and talked to brothers like us. And like yourself, man, you know, you're very powerful, man. You can be a
arbiter of change.
I mean, you know, you can be a benefit to the, you know, to supporting these brothers and sisters too as well. You know what I'm saying? Because, you mm-hmm. know, you went through the fire. You're going through the fire. You know what I'm saying? And you can help them to understand that they don't, you know, don't give up. You know what I'm saying?
Correct.
You know what I'm saying? Because, like, believe me, I'm going to tell you, we always put on this earth for a reason. And that reason is to share experiences with each other, to enlighten each other. Because, like I told my brothers here, we only going to be here for a short amount of time, man. We not going to be mm-hmm. here forever. You know what
exactly.
I'm saying? So you know, so that's the biggest thing we walk this earth for, you
correct.
Know, to reproduce and to share knowledge to among each other, so we all can prosper and love each other. You
correct.
Know what I'm saying?
Correct.
So that's why we walk here for. So, you know, I know my man, I know he's going to invite you to come back, you know, to give, you know, some more, you know, testimonies. Yeah. Like, your type of testimony, man, is the type of testimony people like to hear.
Mm-hmm.
And show that there is hope.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
That, you know what I'm saying? And you in the level of due diligence that you're applying, let them see that's how much they got to get.
And
you know what I'm saying?
An example for other veterans to see, like, I'm not going to stop fighting.
Yeah. And you owe it to yourself, man, and they owe it to you.
Yeah.
And you cannot give them that benefit to deny you. You know what I'm saying?
Well, it gets frustrating, I tell you.
Well, you know, it is, man, but
after
that's
what I'm saying. 70 years.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, look, man, it took me about 7 years to get mine. So I know. Cause, you know, and like you were saying, you know, how they losing your records like that, man. I remember the days back when Baltimore was hiding records in the ceiling, and they just had an incident. They just had an incident about 2 weeks ago. They found a veteran. I think it was in Virginia. They found one of the veteran centers down there that they found records, veterans' records up in the ceiling. You know what I'm saying? So, right. You know, it's not, believe me, it's not the VA itself. It's the people that's in the VA. You know what I'm saying? Mm. Which are imperfect.
Oh, yeah.
Which are imperfect. You know what I'm saying? The VA have a strict goal and doctrine, man, to support the veterans. That's what they're for. They have the biggest budget out of all the government agencies, and that's what they're for. You know
that's
what I'm saying?
That's an interesting point.
To support the veterans. So don't get frustrated with the VA. It's the personnel, which they are imperfect, you know what I'm saying, with their hidden agendas, you know. So you got to be aware of that so it can help you to be comfortable when you deal with those type of, those type of dispositions. And people, you know, of those representatives, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
When you deal with that opposition, you know what I'm saying? Understanding that humble yourself and that help you to be more professional and help you to be more stronger about what you're trying to achieve, you know what I'm saying? And it gets you there, you know what I'm saying? So you know, it's a lot of stuff is out of your control, you know what I'm saying? But you can contain, you can gather that control by your efforts, you know what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
And your lack to falter, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
You're steadfast.
Stay actions. Steady on the grind. Yeah, steady, you know, on the grind.
That's how you achieve. That's the recipe for success with any type of operational organization or whatever. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Right.
All right. So, you know, like, it's good to hear from you, brother. It's good to hear from a brother who's in the fight, because I've been there. We all have been there.
Yes, sir.
And it's not an easy task, believe me. And it's going to be some frustrations, but don't let them frustrate you to the point. What you do is you go about it in another direction.
Yes, sir.
In attacking it. That's all.
Brother Mr.
And we get you that.
Brother Mr. Poncho, thank you for calling in. Thank you, Brother William
thank
McCoy.
Thank you, Citizen, and Mr. McCoy.
Yes.
I really appreciate the conversation and the help.
We're going to go out. While I was talking, I thought about a song I wrote after, and this song is a composite of dealing with persons like Mr. Poncho, Mr. McCoy, and myself and our experiences. It's called Hold On. Mr. Poncho, good talking to you. I'd invite you to call back. We're going to go with this song, Hold On, and then we'll go to a break.
All right.
Yeah. Oh. Yeah, check me out now. Yeah, yo. A lickin' shots just to see the guns pop. He loved that action on the grind till he seen his peers drop. Too many battlefield memorials, he watched the tears drop. One by one, they went away, leaving empty cards and letters that they wrote that they hadn't finished yet. And dreams that they shared that he can't forget. Sometimes he gotta isolate to collect himself. Sometimes he gotta walk away because his face is wet. Yo, at the combat memorial, salute the fallen warriors, retrospectives of their lives illustrated through the. He said, hey, LT, it's getting rough for me. I'm having dreams about the war and what it did to me. I can't sleep at night, I'm always ready to fight. Ain't got no job, and man, it's hard, I'm about to lose my wife. She say I toss and turn and yell and scream in my sleep. And when I fix her face and smile, sometimes I frown, it's deep. Hold on.
Hold on.
Hold on, baby. That's what we gotta do.
Believe.
Mr. Poncho, you gotta hold on.
That's it.
And believe.
It's gonna get better.
Change is gonna come.
I know that.
Yeah.
Hold on.
Yeah, check me out. Daily runs in them 5-ton gun trucks and squad automatics. My man up top would let it go at the hand of static. Light him up, write him up, forget the death toll. Might be time to meet Jamaican kid for whom the bell tolls. Some got stuck with short luck and ain't no memory. The horrors and the misery. Medevac delivery, see sadness and madness. His dreams die young and flags half mast in their towns. KIA on their combat objective. DOA and his mom's is reflected. Standing on their tarmac, the tears and the pain. That soldier ship back in the belly of a plane. Her child in that sealed box, flag draped coffin. She cries herself to sleep at night thinking about him often. All the letters that he wrote, the dreams that he had, he kept a picture in his helmet of his mom and his dad. Hold on. Yeah. Gotta hold on. And believe. It's gonna get better. Yeah. Change is gonna come. Yeah. Yeah. Check me out now. Are you out there, God? Sometimes I wonder. Almost lost my faith among the pillage and plunder. They send us off to war, we fight and pray to one another. The tracing rounds and mortars felt like lightning and thunder. Lord, I made it out the hood, but this almost took me under. First I thought we might be good, till that bomb took out my brother. Now I'm back in the world, trying to recover. Dealing with the nightmares of anger. Look in the mirror, see a child's face instead of my own. Maybe the ones who died by our hands in the war. I washed my hands in the sink, I saw blood instead of water. Hearing Nandad's voice, still talking about his daughter. She was a newborn, born while daddy fought in combat. She never got to know him, cause he died in a bomb attack. Damn. All she has now is pictures on the wall, folded flag in the letter, uniforms that he wore, dog tagged in his medal. Hold on, little girl, you can conquer your fear. You will never be alone as long as I'm here. My word is my bond is my life, and I would give my life before my words should fail. I send my prayers to the essence, hope your dreams come true. I told your pops that if he passed it, I'd look out for you. I told your pops that if he passed it, I'd look out. Little girl, you gotta
hold on.
Yeah. Hold on.
Believe.
Gotta believe. You know what I'm saying?
I know that change is gonna come.
Hold on. Yeah. Much love to my man Big Mac, my man Keith Miles, my man Ilya Edwards, my man Milton Agers. Who am I leaving out, brother? Throw a name up.
You got two.
Big oil can.
Edwards.
My man Edwards, yeah.
You got two Edwards.
Roland Grimes, hold on. This Dodge Citizen, the Veterans Report. What's up with that joint, baby? You like that joint?
Man, that joint's off the hook.
Gotta get it right. We're in the studio getting them right. Listen, I want to thank Mr. Poncho again. That gentleman called in.
He's powerful, man.
When persons like that call in, it helps broaden the dialogue.
That's it, man.
I want to thank Brother McCoy. He's not going to blow his own horn, but he is a dedicated veterans advocate. He went through certain experiences based on his own extraction from the military and his own tactical fight to get what he deserved from the VA and the United States Army. And instead of taking his toolbox and his toys and going in and just isolating, what I have seen and witnessed him do is be a light and a clarion call of enlightenment for other veterans caught up in the struggle. And as I like to say, trying to make a way after combat, trying to make a way after service. And for many veterans, this fight, you know, they get a disabling affliction and they're not able to make the money that they used to make when they were in the uniform or to get a job. And if they don't get their paperwork right at the VA, it can disable and demean them to the point where they just don't feel like they're serviceable in this economy and in this life. So when veterans like Brother McCoy or Mr. Poncho who call up and share their experiences, but through sharing show that there is light at the end of the tunnel. I'm going to continue to fight. I'm going to identify the resources that will help me meet my objective, which is only to get what you deserved. It actually is a motivating energy, and we thank you. We thank you for sharing. And Brother McCoy, do you have anything else you might want to share about your experiences or the experiences of veterans?
Well, you know, like yourself, brother, you know, I've been blessed, you know, to be able to walk on this show and maybe help somebody else.
Yeah.
And like I said, just to give them some level of guidance, which I never got until the latter part of my whole struggle. And once I understood that, you know, it's been a session for me to constantly, whenever I talk to any brother or mm-hmm. sister, mm-hmm. you know, in this area of, you know, of the Veterans Affairs, you know what I'm saying, to, you know, share my experience, mm-hmm. share my knowledge with them, you know mm-hmm. what I'm saying? And, you know, we got a lot of brothers, you know, combat warrior mm-hmm. brothers, who, mm-hmm. you know, combat experience, you know, veterans who are, you know, who are receiving or went through that trial and error and went through that whole trial and tribulations mm-hmm. of dealing with the Veteran Administration, you mm-hmm. know what I'm saying? And to be able to achieve, you know, their level of disability, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And a lot of them are still, you know, denied certain levels, you know mm-hmm, what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And I've seen brothers, man. I've seen brothers, white sisters, white brothers, black brothers.
Latin, everybody.
You know, Hispanic, mm-hmm. Orientals, you know. We all are people. We all, which I hate using that color stigma because we, and, you know, with that green uniform, man, we all are Americans. And yes, that's what I look at as being as Americans.
Yep.
You know, we all that color thing, just nothing there but something there to separate us.
Mm-hmm.
We as a people, man, we are American. Like myself, I don't look at myself being an African American. I look at myself being American, you know.
Mm.
We all have ancestry from different parts of this world, you know. And since being that it's with the whole thing about Africa, man, being that the oldest bones of civilization was found in Africa, that means that all men who walked this earth came from Africa.
Mm.
So, you know, it should be used as an identifier, you know what
mm-hmm,
I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, everybody's in this. I was born in America. Wherever you was born, that's what you are.
Gotcha.
That's the continent that you are. You know, you that's the nationality that you are, you know what I'm saying? And I was born in America, so I'm American.
There you go.
And that the whenever I fill out applications, everything like that, they look for, you know, my nationality. Mm-hmm. I was put down there American or other. Mm. They had that black African and all that stuff. No, I just put down other, you know, American, you know what I'm saying?
Okay.
And let them figure it out, you know what I'm saying? Because I don't have to figure it out because I know, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying? But, you know, like I said, it's just the whole point, man.
When you probably experienced the same thing, and I'm sure you have in football and everything, but when you put that uniform on,
mm-hmm.
when I was sending soldiers to Mosul or to Rashid or to Al-Assad, and they were in that truck,
mm-hmm.
and it was one driver, there was an assistant driver,
mm-hmm.
and it was somebody on the back on a
mm-hmm.
gun mount, it was 120 degrees.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Nobody cared what color anybody was.
That's right.
No, now that may happen. I heard in Vietnam was a little different. You know, like the brothers had to be pointed, was on the front lines or whatever. If that's true,
man,
I don't know if that's
true.
But for
real, man, you know, and I don't give a darn, you know, what campaign we may have been involved with,
mm-hmm.
wherever we were
mm-hmm.
as a people, you know, and I'm talking about the different colors
mm-hmm.
that's been identified, you know, and how we phased in. People of color was phased in latter part mm-hmm. of the, you know, mm-hmm. of the fights to establish America to what America
mm-hmm.
is today.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, it's not the army.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the army. It's not the Air Force.
It's the people.
It's not the Navy. That's mm-hmm. not what all that stands for.
Mm-hmm.
People are imperfect. You're going to have those groups of people of power.
Mm-hmm.
going to impose these type of hidden mm-hmm. agendas, these mm-hmm. type of, mm-hmm. you know, selfish, you know, dispositions, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, the goal, you know, in the military, you know, the goal in the military always is to stay alive.
Correct.
To stay alive.
Yeah,
to complete your mission.
I'll tell you this story, man. We had a, when I was at Baghdad International Airport, I always tell this story. You know, I had one of the most bloodiest, deadliest missions. I was an officer in charge of a gun truck detachment. Mm-hmm. My job, I tell people, well, a lot of times people, civilians ask me, what was your job? My job was to send my friends and family members out in harm's way every day.
They
hope that they didn't get blown up.
That's an officer, man.
You know, every day.
That's an officer, bro.
You know, and because I was running the mission, although I went out on missions,
You know, I didn't go out on the majority of them because right. I had now, I had to be the brain. Right. I was part of the.
Right.
I had to do the. You know, but that's anyway.
Not your position, man.
So, I used to have to send these guys. One of my our trips was from Baghdad International Airport all the way up north to Mosul.
Mm.
Okay, Mosul. Mm-hmm. Okay. And because of the distance, it's an overnight. Most of them, you go and come back the same day.
Yeah.
But because of this, it was like, I think, believe it was 4 hours up and 4 hours back,
mm-hmm.
or three, something close. But
yeah.
So because of this, my job and this mission, we used to get people from active duty components that were also in Iraq, and they would have to detail their people to be gunners and drivers
mm-hmm.
on this mission. My mission was big.
Mm-hmm.
So we would get, and that was a gift that I appreciate now, because I got to meet and interact and manage so many different young soldiers from active duty, from Germany, you know,
mm-hmm.
who happened to be. And I'll never forget one of my not NCOs, Keenan was his name, Sergeant Keenan. He's works for the government now.
Mm-hmm.
And so him and his normal A driver had to go with this new guy that had just recently, I think his name was Ortiz, but don't quote me. I just remember it was one of our Latin brothers
mm-hmm.
from the active duty. No, it was another guy, but I can't think of his name. So they get all the way up to Mosul, and this guy was the gunner. 100-degree weather on the back of the truck, you know, 100-degree
mm-hmm.
weather. And what the soldiers did, when you get to Mosul, Mosul had a pool and something else there, but when you get to Mosul, usually the two guys will go and get some food or some water or something from the store there and bring it back. But you can't leave the truck unsecured.
Right, right, right.
So they'll leave their weapons there once they're on the boat with the one guy. And it's usually the gunner. And back then, the trucks weren't heavied up, so they had sandbags in them.
Mm-hmm.
We made sandbags. So Keenan and our guy went to the store or whatever, and then when they got back, they were going to relieve the other guy, and then maybe another two people would go.
Mm-hmm.
And when they got back, Ortiz, the brother that we didn't know, the Latin guy who had taken all of the sandbags off of the back of the truck by himself and set up the bunk so they could sleep overnight.
Mm.
It's that type of stuff that when you say there's no color, there's no...
There you go.
And I'll never forget, that was survival, like their man. Introduction to...
American survival.
That was their introduction to this soldier.
Yep.
You know what I mean? And it wasn't a colorblind, it was his heart, and his heart was just... And of course, there was an immediate bond, but they were like, man, we do it together. Like, nah. And this is the guy that had been riding on the back in 140 for 4 hours.
Mm-hmm.
That's when statements like what you made about, man, I'm an American, or
yep.
even though we know that in certain situations, we do feel it a certain, even if we might call ourselves Americans, other people may call us black or white or Latin
that's
or Asian, but
that's the people.
But I feel you. And when you said that, that's what I thought. That's what I went back to. I never, ever forget that story. When I came, I remember I said, how'd the run go? How'd the new guy? And then my NCO, my seasoned NCO said, man, LT, I had to fight to wipe a tear. You know what this guy did when we got up? And then he told me this story about this guy. And, of course, like I said, that guy's professionalism, his character, his everything about him, his dutifulness, his it transcended race, culture, ethnicity. It even transcended the fact that he was from another unit that we didn't know about, and he wasn't. Just unbelievable. But anyway, this is the Veterans Report. We got Brother William McCoy in here. Want to thank him for coming in. We hope that he'll be a regular in as much as he can, because he's a very decisively engaged person. But in as much as we can get this brother here, because he's got a wealth of energy and information to share with us and with our listening audience. And not just that, I know him as a 1,000% good guy, period. But as you can see, very charitable with his information, motivation, and enlightenment about veterans' affairs. And that is something that we place in extraordinarily high value here. going to take you out with the service-connected album project, Call My Name song that we came in with. And apologize again, we started out a half hour late. Bernie, the Renaissance man, is supposed to be coming on, but I think I'll let our engineer handle that. But he may be out and about today, so he just may have a musical theme during his time slot. But here we go. Thank you. This is the Veterans Report. Your host, Dodge Citizen. Got brother Roland Grimes. The Roland Grimes Show, 6 to 8 p.m. Mondays. Just out of the camera shot on my right. And then on the left, the dear friend, the brother, and combat veteran, William McCoy. Thank you.
wind farms are monitored 24/7 at our remote operations center, so on-site teams can count on early warning of approaching.